So today we're going to talk about tides. It's going to be a fairly relaxed kind of lecture, last lecture, not too many equations, just descriptive. We'll talk about, well, tides. Tides are variations in the sea level, right? So the first thing you have to think about is, what is the sea level that you're varying around? What is the reference sea level? So we'll talk about the shape of the Earth and the shape of the mean sea level, that's called the geoid. And then we'll look at different tidal frequencies, observations of variations in the sea level in different places. And then we'll try to explain it. So what is it that causes the tides? Anyone got any suggestions? Why do we have tides? You've all seen it, you know, you've been to the beach, well, the Atlantic, not so much the Mediterranean, but you go to the Atlantic coast, you see the sea going out, coming back in, because the sea level's going up and down. Why would it do that? Yeah, the gravitation, you're absolutely right. It's to do with gravitational force, but it's actually quite complicated to understand. I mean, the whole Earth is subject to gravitational force, right? So why should the ocean behave differently from the rest of the planet? That's what we need to understand, right? So we'll talk about tidal forces, what are the forces responsible for these tides? And then we'll, obviously the culprits are the sun and the moon, yeah? Oh yeah, crustal tide, yeah. There are tidal forces which affect the Earth as well, yeah. But it's very small compared to the ocean, because the ocean is a fluid which is free to move, so is the Earth. The Earth is a kind of fluid on the inside as well, but it's much more dense and much more viscous. The ocean can react quickly, so that's why we have these daily variations, you see. The Earth reacts, but by the time it's reacted, the tides already, forces already changed, you see. So we're not going to talk about that. We'll talk about the ocean tide. The atmosphere also is subject to tidal forces. So yeah, everything has tides. Yeah, so the sun and the moon are responsible for this tide, so we'll try to understand how. And then we'll get onto more realistic, detailed descriptions of how the tides vary around the world, and our old friend the Coriolis force will come into play. So let's just think about the shape of the Earth then. What is a horizontal surface? A horizontal surface is a surface where if you put something on it, it won't roll one way or the other, it'll stay there. If you put a ball on a horizontal surface, it'll just stay there. If the surface is not horizontal, it'll start to roll down the surface, right? So the definition of that is something to which the force of gravity is perpendicular, right? It's not necessarily something which is perpendicular to a line that goes to the center of the Earth. It's something which is perpendicular to the local force of gravity. Now, the Earth is not a perfect sphere. Generally speaking, local vertical is not the same as a line that goes towards the center of the Earth. We define the horizontal surface as a surface of geopotential. So if the force of gravity is the gradient of a geopotential, then the surface across which we have that gradient is a local horizontal surface. And so the shape of the Earth, which is made up from that single surface, is called the geoid. And all departures from that geoid for the ocean surface are either associated with tides or with ocean currents. Some of the departures from that geoid are actually fairly steady in time, because the ocean has currents, and so you have the slope of the surface to do with the local horizontal pressure gradient, which is in geostrophic balance with the force, the Coriolis force, and you have a permanent current like the Gulf Stream. Okay, so that there'll be a departure from the geoid, which is steady in time. Well, the Gulf Stream is not steady in time, but varies over longer timescales than the daily cycle, right? And that also needs to be taken into account. So it's variations around that, which are daily, which are the tides, right? So what you need to do is look at different frequencies of variation. But before we get onto that, let's just get back to this question of what shape is the Earth. So it's not a sphere, okay? It's spinning, so it's a kind of oblate spheroid, but it's actually more complicated than that because of geology and continents and all sorts of things. So this is actually the shape of the Earth. It's actually, it looks a bit like a potato. This is a representation of the Earth, which is extremely exaggerated. So all departures from a sphere have been multiplied by some huge factor. The Earth is much more spherical than this, but this just illustrates the departure from sphericity that the Earth has, all right? And so you see this great big dip in the Indian Ocean. You see this bulge over China. You can see a bit of a dip over northern Canada. And it's not even constant in time, this thing. It varies on geological timescales. As you know, you have mountain building, you have continental drift. That's millions of years, right? It also varies on shorter timescales because of glacial effects. So over the last 10,000 years or so, it's gradually changed because of the disappearance of the Laurentide ice sheet here. So Canada is gradually rebounding from the end of the last ice age 10,000 years ago, and it's still moving away from the center of the Earth because that weight has been lifted, right? But for our purposes, for a daily tidal cycle, we can say this is the shape of the Earth. So what are the variations around that, right? So here is a time series of sea level, right? Measured at some coastal station somewhere in England. And so what do you see when you look at that time series? Well, the first thing you notice is that it varies quite quickly. So these are the days. This is about a month along the bottom. So within a day, it's gone up and down twice, basically. And so we have two highs and two lows every day. We have a semi-diurnal tide. The second thing you notice is that the amplitude of this semi-diurnal tide varies throughout the month. Yeah, so you have some periods in the month where it's quite high amplitude and some periods where the amplitude is lower. And there are two of these maxima in the month. If you think back to when I was talking about interference between two waves, this is quite similar to that, right? We were talking about two different wave frequencies and the packet, the modulation packet, remember that, right? So if you have two frequencies which are very similar, they can combine to make something which is a much lower frequency, which modulates the amplitude of that fast signal. This is a sign that we're looking at two different frequencies, tidal frequencies, which are both of them close to the semi-diurnal frequency, but not exactly the same. So that's one way of looking at this. We'll come back to that later. There's a simpler explanation as well. But what could it be? I mean, what could it be that's giving you two different frequencies? There's two things out there that are causing the tides, right? Two great big objects in the sky. One is up there. It's a beautiful day. You can see one of them now. Yeah, the moon and the sun, yeah. So there's two things. They both contribute to the tides, not exactly at the same frequency, so that's where you get this modulation, right? But we'll come back to that.